Thank you so much, Reid Hoffman, for joining us. I mean, this is a fresh of breath air because there is a lot of concern, a lot of worry that AI takes over, the computers will be in charge, and will basically stop using our critical thinking.
Yes, but actually, in fact, if anyone plays with AI today, it is the most amazing educational technology we have created in human history. If you want to learn anything, I use it to learn everything from quantum mechanics to, like, I wonder what cooking sous vide in this way looks like. It's everything.
But I guess the concern is that, you know, especially people that go into a first-time job or students or, like, you know, college kids don't use their critical thinking anymore, because if you just go into chat box and say, write me a sonnet with this, this, and this, it does it for you.
Well, it definitely can do a bunch of things for you, but that can help you elevate your game, right? So it's a little bit like if you were just copying Wikipedia as handing in your essay. Sure, you could do that, but actually, in fact, you should use it to inspire you, to make you think better, to say, hey, like, for example, when I was writing Superagency, I would put in sections and say, how would a history of technology specialist critique what I've said? And then I understand it, and I can decide whether or not I change or edit and so on, and therefore the book gets better.
So, Reid, it doesn't reduce cognitive capabilities, right? This is a big concern that you know, we stop thinking, that we think less, that we think differently.
Well, I think it makes it, just like all technology, you can approach it being lazy. And so if you just say, okay, I'm going to outsource it, just like, for example, I'm going to say, whatever the first search result on Google is, that's the answer. And if you do it that way, then of course that doesn't help you extend. But if you do anything in terms of having it be a dialogue with you, having it extend your capabilities, asking a question, getting an answer, asking another question, then it greatly amplifies your capabilities.
How do you get rid of the biases? Because if you have too many biases, then it skews, of course, democracy.
Well, so all of the major AI labs are trying to get it as kind of, call it, unbiased as possible. Now, within human perspective and human knowledge, there's always some things of bias. We're always learning. Like, if we kind of look at human beings 50 years ago or 50 years past, and we look at them and say, oh, they were biased about this, I'm certain humans 50 years from now will be looking at us the same way. So it's an ongoing process with us as well as the technology.
Reid, is there anything that worries you about AI?
The primary thing that worries me is I call AI the cognitive industrial revolution. It's both for the upside, which is this whole society we live in, middle class, education, medicine, all comes from the Industrial Revolution. That same amplification is coming, but the transitions are difficult. So the thing that primarily worries me is to say, look, we're going to have to navigate this challenging transition, just like the Industrial Revolution was a challenging transition, but that's how we have our children and our future generations be prosperous and have amazing societies. And so that's the challenge we need to rise to.
So what's the right way of either designing AI or designing safeguards for AI?
Yeah, well, part of there's kind of a two-part audience for Superagency. One is the people who are AI fearful or concerned, to help them become AI curious. But it's also for technologists, which is design for human agency, design for increasing human agency. That should be your design principle and fundamental. And the book is also, I hope, helpful for them.
So, Reid, this is basically putting, you know, the human at the center still of everything. So how they fit into the next decade.
Yeah. Well, AI, I think, can be amplification intelligence, not just artificial intelligence, and that amplification, the superpowers that we get. Mm-hmm. And it's not just, part of Superagency is, if you get a superpower, that helps me too. That's how we have Superagency together.
As long as it's democratic and everybody has it, or is that a question for in a second phase?
Well, I think one of the good things about it, and that's part of the reason why the first chapter is about humanity enters the chat a la ChatGPT. When we build technologies for hundreds of millions and billions of people, that's broadly inclusive. So your Uber driver has the same iPhone that Tim Cook has. That's the kind of inclusion that we're targeting.
Reid, I mean, I guess evolution is not necessarily progress, full stop. So how do you make sure that this means progress for the majority of humans?
Well, so I think Look, I think as we iterate and we participate, we make progress. And for example, even though you say, well, we have a whole bunch of cars and that creates climate change, the cars also create our industrial society. And by the way, the way that we tackle climate change is we add carburetor emissions and we add, you know, we invent new kinds of clean energy and we do EVs. And so, you know, I tend to be very, you know, as we do iterative deployment and as we bring humanity into the loop, I tend to think we do make progress. Now, I think, again, you make better progress by having the right kind of design principles, by accepting criticism, by talking about it. So, you know, I describe myself as a bloomer, which is not that technology is just great. It's technology engaging with people is great.
But it also depends on the people in charge. What do you think of Sam Altman's performance so far in leading OpenAI?
Well, so I think Sam's great contribution to humanity will be OpenAI. And that's with having done a number of amazing things before and done amazing investments like Infusion and all the rest. And I think that his ability to think very big and to have bet very hard on this, you know, a little bit of technological thesis of scale compute and scale learning systems is what matters. And that's why OpenAI has brought this current revolution to us. And it's these machines learn, and they learn things that we help them learn and help teach them.
Is there some I know you've also had your differences with Elon Musk. Mm. Who's the person in the space that you, if not admire, listen to the most?
Well, Sam Altman is definitely one of them. Kevin Scott at Microsoft is another. Dario Amodei at Anthropic is another. James Manyika at Google is another. I mean, I think part of the thing that's very important about making AI for humanity is people who listen to others and talk to others and accept criticism. And I think that's one of the things that all of these people are very good at.
Do you need to regulate it? Or is it something that you need to see how it runs and then think about regulating? Afterwards.
So I think what you do is you start with the absolute minimum regulation you could do for the things that could be really bad. Not for, right. Oh, look, it might have a biased picture or might have a biased statement. Like, we can iterate, we can fix those as we're going.
Really bad is what? People taking over planes to crash them?
Yes.
And things like
yeah.
that. It's
terrorism.
Like terrorism.
You know, cybercrime, yeah. et cetera.
Yeah.
Regulate for that, yeah. right? And then do iterative deployment. And by the way, even with iterative deployment, you eventually get to further regulations. So, like, for example, if you tried to make everything perfect with cars before you put them on the road, we'd never have cars. So you put them on the road, and you go, oh, this for bumpers, this for window wipers, this for... And occasionally, like, the market doesn't want seatbelts, the car manufacturer doesn't want seatbelts, and then, of course, the regulators come and say, oh, no, seatbelts is good, we're going to add those.
If you regulate for things, I mean, terrorism is bad actors, bad state actors,
yes.
How do you regulate it unless you have to protect yourself? So it's basically finding the technology that blocks them?
Well, I think the regulation is if you're releasing the technology to the general public, which could be to the bad actors as well,
yeah.
you're doing red teaming and safety.
Right.
You're putting the right security measures to make sure that you're not bleeding the technology right. to rogue states, terrorists, etc. Yeah. That you have a safety plan that if you go, okay, why is the technology I'm building, if it does leak or anything else, why will it still be safe? And how do we continue to have the technology that makes anything that's in the wild as safe as possible.
On Elon Musk, do you think he has too much power being so close to the president?
Well, so, look, I think he's a celebrated entrepreneur, but I think that governments are not companies. Like, for example, risking a company, like, for example, say, oh, our 10 rockets blow up. Who cares? It doesn't matter. The financial system of a country blows up. That's the Cultural Revolution. That's terrible. So you actually have to say we take less risk here, even at the price of some inefficiency, because it's more important for us to not have things blow up.
So do you worry that things are going too quickly with the Trump administration?
Well, I worry that very bad risks are being taken. Speed is not a problem. Risks are a problem. And, you know, for example, it's like, well, we're just going to fire a whole bunch of people. Oh, oops, we fired a whole bunch of nuclear safety inspectors. Like, that's the kind of thing that's taking risks that is unwarranted.
Reid, I also want to talk to you about China, because DeepSea kind of got everyone, you know, at the edge of their seat. But where do you have a good understanding about where China is on AI?
I have a reasonable understanding. I do a fair amount of talking to various people in China in order to make sure. Part of the thing that when last year I was going around saying there was an economic race with AI between the West and China, people were like, oh no, you're overblowing that because you just simply don't want to be regulated. And I think with DeepSeek and everything else, we see that that race is there. And the Chinese government has said that they want to be, you know, AI leaders, like leading the world by 2030. I think the race is on. I think it's very important for us and our industries to actually, in fact, be winning.
But is this the new arms race?
Well, I don't call it an arms race because it's primarily an economic race. There is arms stuff, components of it, but yes, it is the economic race.